Dear colleagues, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be today again together for the European Society of Gynecology for that webinar activity. Today, we will have a fantastic topic for interest in clinical practice, is the functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. And we will have two speakers who are the Professor Blazej Meskakalski and Professor Alessandro Genazzani. The Professor Blazej Meskakalski is chairman of the Department of Gynecological Endocrinology at Poznan University and also president of the Polish Society of Gynecological Endocrinology, and is a board member of the International Society of Gynecological Endocrinology, but also of the European Society of Gynecology and of the European Menopause and Andropause Society. Professor Blazej Meskakalski and Alessandro, can you open your video and your audio, please? Okay, thank you. And the first presentation is from Professor Blazej Meskakalski, who is will speak about stress, kisspeptin, and reproduction. Then I will inform everybody, 1 second, that please, if you have question for Professor Meskakalski and Professor Genazzani, write your question in question and answer. And at the end of both presentation, I will read the question and they will answer. Please, Blazej, you have the microphone.
Thank you very much, Professor Genazzani. It's a great honor to have presentation during this webinar. I will talk about stress, reproduction, and kisspeptin. We know that both processes are very complicated. Stress is complicated process, reproduction. We still don't know everything about all of the mechanisms related to stress, related to reproduction, and interplay between these both processes. And possibly the link between both processes is the peptide, which is named kisspeptin. I will try to present this topic. I would like to mention about this gentleman, Jeffrey Winfield Harris. He was a kind of the pioneer or father of neuroendocrinology, because before the time when we know about neurohormonal function of hypothalamus, he was the first who indicated the possible neuronal control by hypothalamus of the pituitary gland. And what's about the history of the work on the stress? Walter Cannon from the Harvard University was first who introduced the term stress. It was in 1920. It means more than 100 years ago. But this gentleman, Hans Hugo Seli, the Hungarian Canadian endocrinologist, devoted more than 50 years of his work on the stress. And he was the first who indicated that the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis is the main axis involved in the stress response. His nickname was the Dr. Stress. He was nominated 10 times for the Nobel Prize in Medicine, but he has never received this Nobel Prize. And at the end of the 60s and the beginning of 70s, the big revolution in the sense of the formation of the new part of endocrinology, new endocrinology, took place. These two gentlemen, they are still alive, Andrzej Szaly and Roger Julin. Andrzej Szaly was born before the Second World War in the territory of Poland. He was Polish, he's Polish and Jewish and American origin. And these two gentlemen, they work on the neurohormones and discover TRH, thyrotropin releasing hormone, and GnRH in 1971, and shortly, a few years after, they were awarded by the Nobel Prize in Medicine for discovery of these neurohormones. What is GnRH? GnRH is very simple peptide. It's composed of only of 10 peptides, but it plays very important role in the governing of the reproduction. It is mainly secreted by hypothalamus during pregnancy in placenta, by placenta, and small amounts by gonads. It was very important to discover the character of the secretion of GnRH because it is secreted by the pulsatile manner. It was found by Ernst Knobel, German-American endocrinologist. He discovered that it's secreted in the pulsatile manner and made a term GnRH pulse generator. Why hypothalamus is such important? It's not only important from the reproductive point of view, but is the center responsible for food intake, for thermoregulation, for sleep regulation, blood pressure regulation, sexual function. And it's important that these all the processes are integrated, and there's, for instance, the interplay between food intake and reproduction. And the main role of GnRH is the stimulation of both gonadotropin FSH and LH synthesis and release. And another important peptide related to the stress, but in some part also to reproduction, is corticotropin releasing hormone, CRH. It was discovered by Willie Weil in 1981. It means 10 years after identification of the GnRH, is the main mediator of the stress response, but also has influence on the reproductive function because increased secretion of the CRH can cause inhibition of the GnRH. And now kisspeptin. The kisspeptin story is not such long. It was discovered, the kisspeptin gene, at the end of the previous century in the Hershey in United States. Therefore, the name is kisspeptin, probably because this place, this city, is famous for kiss chocolates. You have here the dates when the receptor of this kisspeptin was discovered and peptide composed of 54 amino acids in 2001. And it's important to stress that at the beginning, when this gene was discovered, it was characterized as the metastatic suppressor gene of melanoma cells and breast cancer cells. And it was thought that this peptide will be mainly related to the oncological field. But this publication from 2003 completely changed our view on the kisspeptin. Why? Because this publication revealed that a mutation of the in the kisspeptin receptor causes the inhibition of the puberty and also the inhibition of the normal reproductive development. Here you have the impression of the contemporary endocrinologist Walid Dilo from London about these changes of his view on the kisspeptin. Now, at the beginning, oncological peptide, now peptide mainly related to reproduction. And why kisspeptin is such important? Because after this, starting from 2003, a lot of research was done, and we found that kisspeptin is kind of the positive regulator of the pulsatile GnRH secretion. The kisspeptin neurons are located on the GnRH neurons. From this point of view, it's very important regulator of hypothalamic pituitary axis, generally the menstrual cycle, and also the fertility in the sense of the ovulation process. In 2008, it was discovered that in some part of the hypothalamus, in arcuate nucleus, the hispeptin neurons are expressed, but they are expressed not alone, but together with neurokinin B and dynorphin neurons, and is the interplay between these neurons. For instance, dynorphin can inhibit hispeptin secretion, and neurokinin B neurons can stimulate hispeptin secretion. Why also, apart from this relationship between hispeptin and GnRH, why hispeptin is such important? It was found that different stimuli from the metabolic state of our system, our organism, can influence the hypothalamus, and through the different peptides or neurotransmitters listed here, GABA, neuropeptide Y, AGOTI-related protein, can influence the Kindy neurons, and in turn, Kindy neurons, after the receiving the metabolic signal from the body, can influence the GnRH secretion. And here you have kind of the cartoon. It's also positive relation between leptin, which can give the signal from the fat tissue, that in the adequate nutritional state, where is the enough secretion of the leptin, it has a proper stimulation of the kispeptin, and kispeptin can have the positive influence on the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis. Contrary situation in the undernutrition, low serum levels of leptin cannot stimulate the kispeptin, and therefore is the inhibition of hypothalamic pituitary action. Another study revealed that kispeptin is important within the hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis from the two points of view, as the important mediator of the pulse generator, GnRH pulse generator, and also surge generator. In other words, can influence the LH pulsatility, proper pulsatility before the ovulation. And now, a few words about functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. According to the term or the name, we know that this is a functional disorders, not related to the organic background. Generally, we can say that is characterized by the disarrangement of the GnRH pulsatile secretion. It means can be disarrangement of the GnRH pulsatility and also GnRH pulsatility amplitude, but mainly pulsatility. And here you have the kind of the overview, the pre-puberty time, when there is still not formed the proper pulsatility, adulthood, proper pulsatility of the gonadotropin secretion, and this disarrangement of gonadotropin secretion in the hypothalamic amenorrhea case. Generally, we can distinguish three types of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea: stress-related, weight loss-related, and exercise-related. Of course, sometimes in, let's say, one patient, it's difficult to distinguish that, for instance, the cause is only, let's say, excessive exercise. For instance, in the professional athletes, we can see all of the elements: stress, weight loss in the sportsman, and also excessive exercise. And we also know that in the functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, the kind of the final negative consequence is the profound hypoestrogenism. And this profound hypoestrogenism can have negative impact on the whole body. It's not only the interruption of the menstruation, because hypoestrogenism like in, for instance, menopausal patient, can have negative influence on the brain function in the sense of concentration problems, memory problems, mood changes, more depressive mood. A cardiovascular system can also be impaired in the sense of the changes in the more atherogenic lipid profile or impaired endothelial function. Also important aspect is the negative influence on the bone. When the functional hypothalamic amenorrhea is in the close to the peripubertal time, it can have negative impact on the attainment of the peak bone mass, and also can have influence due to hypoestrogenism on the decrease of the bone mass, bone mineral density, and the increased risk of fractures. Of course, hypercortisolemia generally is related to patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. And what is the interplay between stress and reproduction? Stress axis and reproductive axis. Here is the kind of the old pictures, old slide from a very good scientist, Professor John Chrusos, who made a lot of work in this field. You can see that CRH dotted line can directly inhibit GnRH secretion. The increased level of glucocorticosteroids can inhibit gonadotropins and GnRH. Or on the other hand, CRH can stimulate beta endorphin, and beta endorphin in turn can inhibit GnRH secretion. And if you look in the literature, you can see that majority of the patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea are characterized by increased total cortisol serum levels in circulation and also in cerebrospinal fluids. Here is my publication based on my work when I arrived 26 years ago to University of Pisa, to Department of Professor Genazzani, and I made the study. It was published in 2000 in European Journal of Endocrinology. We measured the mean serum ACTH response to CRH in patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. And you can see that in patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, this response is totally decreased. Similarly, the serum cortisol response to CRH in patients with hypothalamic amenorrhea is significantly decreased in relation to the control patient. But what is important, what was discovered during the last years, is very interesting that CRH receptors are expressed in arcuate nucleus kisspeptin neurons, and glucocorticoid receptors are also expressed in this nucleide where kisspeptin neurons are located. Therefore, from this point of view, probably the CRH cannot directly inhibit the GnRH secretion, but through the action of kisspeptin. Here is kind of the figure, and you can see that mediation of the CRH signal on the GnRH pulsatility is through the kisspeptin. Probably similar situation is with the hyperprolactinemia. Prolactin receptors are expressed in the kisspeptin neurons. Another important element is referred to the gonadotropin inhibitory hormone. It was identified in 2000. In humans, it is referred to the RF-amide-related peptide. And some of the GnRH neurons have expression of the glucocorticosteroid receptors. Therefore, under the stress, glucocorticosteroids can stimulate the gonadotropin inhibitory hormone, and it can inhibit the GnRH secretion. Here you have the kind of the summary of this action. And to summarize this part of my topic, you can see how many different neuropeptides are involved in this interplay between stress and reproduction. The majority of them are increased after under the stress. Bikispeptin is decreased. And now some information about our research, which I made together with very good and quite long collaboration with Professor Alessandro Genazzani. Here we try to study the pulsatility of the kispeptin and pulsatility of LH in healthy women. And we try to find what is the kispeptin, because previously in healthy women we knew about LH pulsatility, but we didn't know about kispeptin pulsatility. And we try to evaluate kispeptin pulsatility and try to evaluate what is the co-secretion or if there is copulsatility between kispeptin and LH. And here, after the big help and support of Alessandro, this difficult statistical analysis, we found for the first time that kispeptin and LH are co-secreted at the same time, and the peaks occurred at the same time point. We published also our work in the GRAM that the patient with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea are characterized by increased CRH serum secretion and decreased serum kispeptin secretion. Another study we made also to evaluate the kispeptin and LH pulsatility, but in the patient with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. We did it also with Professor Alessandro Genazzani. We divided this group of the patient to two groups with low levels of LH and normal LH. And we found that patients with very low level of LH are characterized by lower levels of serum levels of kispeptin. And what is interesting, that was also negative correlation between cortisol and pulsatility of LH. And some few words about possible use of kispeptin as the treatment tool. There are only still is in the level of experimental study. Only few patients were enrolled to the study, but here you have the kispeptin administration in healthy women, twice daily subcutaneous injection. And they found that on the 7, 11, and 14th day of the cycle was important increase of the LH. Here they try to give the kispeptin subcutaneously twice daily to patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. They noticed that on the first day was the potent increase of the both gonadotropins, but on the fourth day, due to the sensitization probably of the receptors, was the tachyphylaxis. And later, the same group of the researchers compared the twice daily to twice weekly administration of the kispeptin. Twice weekly administration gave better results in the sense of the influence on the gonadotropins. Here, the intravenous infusion in control to the vehicle caused also the quite good influence on the LH pulses. And the quite new study, no administration of the kispeptin, but kispeptin receptor agonist, published 3 years ago, in comparison to native kispeptin, better result in the sense of the influence of the FSH and LH. And at the end of my presentation, some clinical approach to the patient with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. So far as I know, we have only one clinical guideline considering a diagnosis and treatment of patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. It was prepared by Endocrine Society and published in JCM 2017. They recommend which hormones, for instance, should we measure and which other parameters in the blood, apart from FSH and LH and estradiol. They also pay our attention that the evaluation of bone mineral density is important for in this patient, particularly when the secondary amenorrhea lasts more than 6 months. And they also tell something about the treatment, that in the treatment of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, very important is to talk with the patient, encourage the patient to eliminate the stimuli which causes the problem. For instance, if is the important weight loss, to is important to encourage the patient to weight gain, or in the patient, let's say, with the excessive exercise, is important to encourage to decrease the physical activity. Some psychological support or cognitive behavioral therapy is important. They also suggest kind of the adjuvant treatment in the sense of the hormonal treatment. They do not recommend oral contraceptive treatment, but they suggest the use of the natural estrogen, for instance, transdermal therapy with estradiol, and use the together as the sequential therapy with the oral progestin. And maybe some new direction, other field, BDNF, melanocortin receptor, nesfatin 1 in FH. And in conclusion, kisspeptin is important regulator of the reproductive function at the sense of the physiological background, but play also very important role, kind of the main role in the pathophysiology of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, maybe possibly used as the therapeutic tool kisspeptin in the future. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Meskakalci. Thank you, Blase, for that fantastic lecture on this new peptide of great importance, such as kisspeptin. And then now we want to move to the second presentation. The second presentation will be done by Professor Alessandro Genassani, already mentioned what the study done together with Blase. It's pleasant, dear friends, to have that beautiful webinar where we can put together persons who have experience to collaborate together from years. And Alessandro Alessandro Genassani is an endocrinologist and obstetrics and gynecologist. Is professor and chief of the section of gynecological endocrinology in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at the University of Modena, and is also secretary of the postgraduate school of Obstetrics and Gynecology at the University of Modena. Is the actual president of the Italian Association of Gynecology and Endocrinology, and is member of several societies, scientific societies, such as Endocrine Society, International Menopause Society, in the International Society of Gynecological Endocrinology. And Alessandro will make a presentation on integrative approach to functional hypothalamic amenorrhea and the use of low-dose estrogen. Please, Alessandro, you have the microphone and you can make the presentation.
Thank you, Andrea.
I remind to all of you to send your question in the question and answer, to write your question, then I will read the question at the end of the presentation. Please, Alessandro, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Andrea, for the presentation, and thank you to Biagio. He made a wonderful presentation, since most of the things that we are talking about today need to have in your brain the structures and the complex descriptions that Professor Meskakalci gave us. The items here is not only to understand how the neuroendocrinology is impaired in functional amenorrheic patients, but mainly how we can act somehow on the systems just to improve the recovery of such functioning of the reproductive axis. Okay, you already have understood that is the combination of different kinds of stressors that are able to induce the blockade of the ability to have ovulation and reproduction. But we have always to remember, as Professor Melchegalsky told us, that is a combination of all the three items, the physical stress, the metabolic stress, and the psychological stress. Obviously, the ability of stress to act as a negative effect on our reproductive axis is not really a negative one. Stress means a sort of adaptive ability of our biology to respond to external stimuli that are probably dangerous and probably are not so good for the biology of women to have the risk of getting a pregnancy, maybe in the hours after having such kind of risk of stress. It's quite easy to understand that this is something which is not really probably important today in the modern way of living of the human being, but probably this was an essential effect that has to be take occurrence when the Neanderthal man with his wife was just moving inside the Paleolithic areas where our biology was in those times living, where Homo sapiens and the ability to find food or to survive were absolutely, absolutely different and difficult. So we have to keep in mind that we are the evolution of those kinds of men and women. I would like just to focus on one couple of items. This is the beginning of the story, various millions of years ago, when the man probably started to understand that he could have food also eating dead animals. And starting from that, he was just eating the inner part of the bone and later trying to go hunting, getting animals and eating proteins. So check how the brain was improving in the dimensions and in the volumes inside the skull. Well, when the man learned how to collect vegetables and maybe to collect the grain, well, they go for hunting reduced. And check here, the brain started to shrink a little bit. So this is just an important message, just to tell you that proteins are a relevant nutrient for our biology. And most of the issues that we have nowadays in modern times in regards of reproduction is that we do not have the right amount of proteins to sustain reproduction. Let's understand better this. During all the times, this was the pyramid for our way of having food. You see, meat and fish were well represented. Nowadays, this part of kind of nutrients are very reduced in the amount, and the actual pyramid, it's fitting a lot with the higher occurrence of the cases of hypothalamic dysfunctions and mainly of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. But why this is happening? We have to remember something that we have probably learned during our school of medicine, when someone told us that from the red meat, the cow or the horse meat, we were getting the most important essential amino acids contained in the proteins, and among these, lysine. Lysine is the almost only amino acid that is able to improve the amount of carnitines produced, and is the carnitine, the relevant key to collect the free fat acids so that to produce energy inside the mitochondria, mainly all over the body, but in great part inside our brain. And remember that a strict vegetarian diet might lead to deficiency of carnitine, since red meat is not the richest source of proteins in these patients. So the problem nowadays are completely different from the Paleolithic women, but we have still stress in the working activity, familiar problem, the weight control or dieting, which are the issues before summertime when we have the problem of getting the bikini on, And it's almost important to understand that such kind of stressors might act as acute just once or chronic, and is the chronic one the most negative one, since, as you can see, the chronic one hits the brain constantly through the physic, the metabolic, and obviously the psychological effects. Well, such kind of situation are negative because induce specific defensive behavior inside the biology of the humans, mainly in women, where reproductive axis is very sensitive to such kind of changes. And we have to remember that stress is not really negative, since it permits to the biology to defend itself from the negative situations occurring all around her. The real problem is that when we have the reduction of the energy, the excess of energy consumption, not enough nutrition, well, such kind of situation reduce the release of gonadotropins, mainly of LH. This is the very first study that stated this, that the occurrence of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea is able to reduce LH secretion, but not the pulsatile release. So we have a lower amount of LH, but pulses are still there, not able to stimulate the ovary. Well, the connection between reproduction and food is related to the fact, as Biagio Malcegalski told us, that fat tissue through leptin and the modulation of insulin, but also the area of the gastrointestinal tract through GH relin, cholecystokinin, and other endocrine elements is able to talk with the hypothalamus, giving specific informations on the status of the energy introduced and available for the entire biology, mainly also for reproduction. And we still have to remember that when we have to face a patient with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, we have to talk to this young lady that inside the biology, reproductive axis is not in the top part of the most important organs and tissues that the biology tries to make it functioning. It's the last one, because the only effort of the biology is to have the lady, the women, to survive to the negative effects of the environmental situations. So brain is the first one, and probably the reproductive axis is the last one, or probably around the last position. And most important is that all the signals coming from the periphery are able to communicate with the hypothalamus, and mainly to act on the hypothalamus through a reduced production of brain-derived neurotropic factor, which is a sort of tropin maintaining the good functionings of the neurons inside the brain and inside the hypothalamus. The reduction of such kind of compounds creates a situation which is not to compensate the excess of reactive oxygen substances, which are produced due to stress and obviously due to the excessive ability of the organs to try to face the stress and conditions and the undernutrition, so that we have an excessive of production of oxidation. And such kind of oxidation is at the basis of the reduction of other functioning, which is the reduction of cognition, the reduction of synaptic plasticity, which are at the basis of the impairment of a lot of other diseases that are not occurring acutely in patients with a functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, but are story occurring later on, couple of years, 5 years, 10 years after the beginning of the functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. So at the basis of this, there is a change in the nutrients habits, and this creates conditions that are reducing the amount of insulin produced due to the reduction of the amount of glucose available, improving the lipid catabolism and the ketoacidosis. And this creates first inabilities inside the liver functioning. And all of this creates a sort of adaptation from the adrenal gland, which creates excess of cortisol, excess of adrenaline and glucagon just to compensate the reduction of the availability of energetic compounds. But most important, and this is very important for any clinician to be known, is the so-called low T3 syndrome. Whenever we have a patient with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, please create a condition to have the assay of free T3, because this is an indicator of a sort of attention of the biology to reduce the amount of energy dispersed inside the human biology to produce heat, to maintain the temperature. Functionally, this is a system just reducing the amount of energy to produce heat in the advantage of having energy for the ability of other organs to work. So this is quite important just to remember. So the connection between the stress acting on the neuroendocrinology and the stress acting through the metabolic pathways and the lack of the right nutrients create the conditions for the reduced activity of the reproductive axis. So we can say that probably this was the first man that understood absolutely that nutrition and metabolism are the key factors for having a healthy surviving of every day for the human beings. Mr. Ludwig Feuerbach was an anthropologist, a philosopher. He was always saying that man is what he eats. And this is just linking the brain, the culture, the acquisition of information, the socialization among the men. But the same issues are absolutely valid when we talk about metabolic addiction in these patients. So the anamnesis for these patients need to focus in the understanding of what kind of lifestyle these patients have. And please visit the patients, try to understand the patients, and a little trick, check the hands, and obviously check the color of the hands, because the palm of the hands have a clear tendency to the yellow, orange, or red, according to the amount of vegetables that these patients are getting as food, as a predominant food, classically. Well, when we talk about functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, we have to think that it's occurring all along fertile life in women. It is not a situation occurring in young ladies, but as you can see from this cartoon, the problem is occurring up to 39, 40 years of age. And always is the interconnection between the presence of stressors with an adaptation inside the brain and the hypothalamus for the amount of neuropeptides, mainly opioids, that are produced inside the hypothalamus. And remember something, that if we focus a little bit on the issues of being too lean or being too fat, you can see you have too much of something. Too much, very few food for patients who are very lean and with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. On the other side, we have too much of food in patients who are obese with too much fat tissues that are going towards amenorrhea, but the situation is related and linked always to metabolism. Metabolism in both conditions creates the conditions to block the reproductive axis. So finally, we have to think that insulin and all the metabolic signals coming from the periphery of the biology is able to talk and to create informations and stimulations on the key speptin neurons. You see here how Professor Maciegalski is right. Everything is going around the key speptin, and insulin is going to be high in very fat patients with hyperinsulinemia, or too low in patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. So reduction of stimulation, increase of stimulations, creates impaired gonadotropin release from the hypothalamus. And you see very well that the key speptin story is a key factor. And Professor Maciegalski clearly showed us how relevant is key speptin in the controlling of a lot of activity. And this pectin is sensitive also to the fact that inside the blood we have different levels of estradiol, of estrogens, during the menstrual cycles or during the women life. Well, so specific neurons inside the AVPV area or those of the Kisspeptin neurons inside the arcuates area are sensitive to the positive, the first ones, or to the negative feedback. And this is a key element that drives the ability to secrete a right amount of GnRH during the follicular and then during the surge for the ovulation in the phases of the menstrual cycles. But this is something that we have to keep in mind when trying to understand how things are going and how we can take advantage of this when we try to recover in these patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea the occurrence of the functions of the hypothalamo-pituitary axis. Also, leptin and GHRLin are talking and stimulating on these neurons, secreting, obviously, Kisspeptin. So everything is interconnected. Everything is very complex. And when we have to think how to manage patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, we might have completely different probability in terms of acting. We might act on the blockade of opioids, maybe on the neurotransmitters, dopamine, GABA, serotonin, or maybe on hormones, cortisol, prolactin, thyroid hormones that are able to affect and to act on the reproductive axis. But the real important one is the last one, feeding and energy balance. We have the need to control a correct lifestyle in these patients. They have, or they need to have, the input and the uptake of right nutrients. So we have made a lot of experience in Modena, but also together with my brother in Pisa and also with Professor Marcegalski, we made a lot of study trying to understand what it might be the right solution just to focus on the reinduction of the ability of the hypothalamo-pituitary axis to start again the ovarian stimulation. And there are, you see on the left hand, a lot of substances that might be used to promote such kind of effects. Quite complex, quite complicated in such cases. But we recently made experience using carnitines with combinations of with other substances such as N-acetylcysteine and L-arginine, but also very low levels of estrogens, such as estriol or hyperlow doses of estradiol. Well, starting on one issue, carnitine is very important. I already told you, it has been clearly demonstrated that it's produced by the degradation of lysine, and it's a key element for the sustain of the neurons and all the astrocytes, helping the neurons to work perfect. So it's coming from a nutrient, which is meat, relevant for us. Well, carnitine is important since it improves the beta oxidation inside the neurons and inside all over the cells in our biology. So it's rather important to be present inside our nutrition, something improving the amount of carnitine. We very a long time ago, almost 25 years ago, we have tested the use of carnitines in these patients as integrative approach. 2 grams of acetyl carnitine, you can see here, was able to induce to restore the improvement of the secretion of LH under the GnRH stimulation. But importantly, it was able to reinduce the elevation of LH plasma levels and to the presence again of correct amount of pulses of correct amplitude just to stimulate the ovarian activity. Well, in the time, we further controlled such kind of effects, and we found that the integration in these patients with carnitines was able to improve not only the baseline levels of LH, but also to improve the response of LH to the naloxone infusion. You know very well that naloxone is able to counteract the opioidergic blockade in the release of GnRH. And this creates the condition through carnitine to improve again the restoration of a correct release of LH. You see here the maximum delta under the naloxone test, and here they improved the incredible amount of the area under the curve of LH. But we went further. With the help of Professor Maciegalski, we made a wonderful study in a group of patients with a functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, well detected, well controlled, well defined, combining smaller amount of carnitines, or more or less than 1 gram every day, but with the presence of arginine and N-acetylcysteine. These are, together with vitamins E and vitamin C, relevant antioxidants. And we made a very interesting observation, since we found that such integration with antioxidant and carnitines were able in these patients where we were not compulsing these patients to change their lifestyle, but we were able to improve the LH release, to improve the levels of insulin, and to reduce the amylase in patients with very low levels of LH, with minimal changes in patients with a normal level of LH. Well, this is an important point of discussion, since patients with hypothalamic amenorrhea might have a normal level of LH, and some others might have a very low level of LH. For us, in our department, levels of LH below the level of 3 milliunits per milliliter means that you are hypogonadotropic. And such kind of patients are those having the best results in terms of recurrence and recovery of the function of the pituitary activity in terms of reproduction. Why the other ones are not able to show differences or improve of the situations in terms of reproductive hormones? Because they are not so bad in the issues of the functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. They have the blockade for the ovarian function, but the pituitary has not really blocked so much. And such kind of effects are still demonstrated when we have the GnRH stimulation test. You see, patients with normal levels of LH do not have any change with the treatment, but those with hypo levels were characterized by an improved in the response to GnRH secretion. And this is relevant because it gives us the idea that inside the pituitary, there is the restarting of the production of LH and the collection of these in the Golgi vesicles inside the cell. Well, when we were just testing such kind of situations in these patients, we demonstrated also that in patients with low levels of LH, we had absolutely the improvement of a lot of other issues. First of all, the recovery of the levels of free T3, the so-called low T3 syndrome, is improved in terms of the fact that FT3 is increasing again, but we have the reduction of cortisol, the reduction of amylase, we have the improvement and the implement of the levels of insulin together with the levels of LH and also of FST. Interestingly, also the 17 hydroxyprogesterone to cortisol ratio improved, since the level of cortisol were going down. So this means that the cortisolemia is reduced for a lower implication of the adrenal gland. 17-hydroxyprogesterone is coming also from adrenal, yes, but also from the ovary. So probably something is recovered inside the functions of the ovary. Well, together with Biagio, Professor Maciegalski, we compared this treatment in these patients, and we found that in these patients with very low levels of LH, a lot of impaired connections between hormones, between insulin and LH, FT3 and LH, cortisol androgens, LH and estradiol, were absolutely improved and restored to normality with at least 12 weeks of treatment with such kind of integration of carnitines together with N-acetylcysteine and L-arginine. Obviously, not all these patients recovered menstruation, but we were able to demonstrate the improvement of the level of LH. Is relevant the fact of the presence of the antioxidant substances, since they are acting also blocking the reactive oxygen substance negative effects on the brain, on the BDNF production, and mainly on the synaptic plasticity inside the hypothalamus. All such kind of effect are collateral to the presence of carnitines and also to a such of, fake signal coming with carnitines, similar to the fact as these ladies have taken some meat, red meat. And why everything is working perfectly? Well, remember that the arginine and N-acetylcysteine are usually able to modulate the production of nitric oxide. And nitric oxide is a relevant element to maintain the production and the recovery of glutathione, the most important antioxidant inside our biology. And such kind of situations takes the advantage of the presence on one side of the presence of a good mitochondrial reactivity in terms of metabolic pathways through carnitines, but on the other side, we have the improvement of the effects of the antioxidation that creates the connection for a perfect reconstitution of glutathione. So when we have to check what kind of treatment might be used as integrative approach to these patients, probably a synergic combination of carnitines, arginine, N-acetylcysteine might be the good ones. And probably this is very good for patients that really have a very low levels of LH. But I have to add something. I know that I'm taking time, but it's relevant to give a new issue that we have developed in our department, the use of weak estrogens. Well, I have already shown you this cartoon where estrogens in low levels or in high levels are modulating the Kisspeptin neurons with a positive feedback, low levels of estrogens in the IVPV area, or with a negative feedback, high level of estrogens in the arcuate nucleus. Well, this is a paper from my brother, 1978. This is an incredible bursting idea that I have taken out just going through the past when my brother, together with Professor Facchinetti and Petraglia, have discovered that the use of a very weak estrogen, such as epimestrol, was able to induce the recovery of the levels of LH in a group of patients with a hypothalamic aminorrhea. Well, we attempted to go through this using, for short term, but also for long term, the use of such kind of weak estrogen, such estriol. Estriol is a very common estrogen, is a degradative element from the estradiol in our biology. So we used 2 milligrams of estriol in these patients for a short term treatment. And as you can see here, we were able to induce in few days, 10 days more or less, the restoration of not really high levels of LH, but significant improved level of LH and FSH. And interestingly, we improved the response to the GnRH stimulation. As you can see here, the maximum delta, the maximum response of both gonadotropins to the stimulation. Well, such kind of situations were then repeated in a more complicated on one side, but longer experimental design, treating this another group of patients for 12 weeks, so for 3 months in a row. And you see here, again, the level of LH were improved higher than with the short-term treatment. And again, here we were able to have the improvement of the response to the GnRH stimulation. Probably such kind of effect were due not only on one side on the effects inside the hypothalamus, but probably also inside the pituitary, because there are specific data demonstrating that estriol is able to induce the expression of the receptor for GnRH on the gonadotropic cells. And when we tested also the presence of such kind of response using very low levels of estradiol, as low as 2 nanograms for 2 times every day, below the tongue, sublingual administration, you see here we were able again to improve the levels of LH and the response also to the bolus of GnRH. Such kind of demonstration gives us the idea that we probably were acting with so low doses of estriol or estradiol that probably we might act and we were able to act on those areas of the hypothalamus where the Kisspeptin neurons sensitive to the positive feedback were working and waiting for such kind of stimulation. And you see here, when we tested with naloxone, again, these patients under the so very low levels of estradiol sublingual, we had the recovery of the response to the naloxone infusion. And the levels of LH were improved in comparison to baseline. We were also able to demonstrate a completely different ability of the adrenal gland to respond to the naloxone infusion, since we recovered also a sort of response of cortisol to the naloxone infusion. So this gives us the idea that probably the very low concentration of estrogens were able in this case to act on the expression of specific neurons inside areas of the hypothalamus where estradiol might induce expression of more receptor for opioids, able on these to act naloxone or naltrexone, so that we have higher stimulation for cortisol secretion in these patients treated with very low levels of estradiol. So here comes a completely interesting aspect of on how to treat these patients. The issue is to induce the recovery of the patients not giving contraceptives, which is most important because treatment with oral administration of estrogens and progestins need to be done only when we are not able to induce the spontaneous endogenous recovery of the menstrual cycle. At least the procedure need to be done with a treatment with oral contraceptive within 2 hours, for 2 years from the beginning of the functional amenorrhea. As Malczegalski told us, attention has to be given to the bone mass. And ovulase, we need to take clear in our mind that the peak of the bone mass is reached within the 20-25th year of age. So whatever is occurring before that time is able to affect negatively the bone mass. And obviously, there are a lot of papers stating on how to approach such kind of patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, but we have always to act on these, to the improvement of the energy availability through food, trying to recover the menstrual functions spontaneously, and the treatment, if we need to act on these, need to create attention on the bone density. And this is rather important since the demonstrations are clear that the treatment with the standard oral contraceptives using ethinyl estradiol and progestins are not able to improve the bone mass in patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. And substantially, we might maintain the bone mass low, but not improve the bone mass. And the relatively recent paper by Gambacciani clearly demonstrated that the oral contraceptive is improving the bone mass only when the patient is recovering a normal habit in having food and in a very good nutrition acquisition of the nutrients able to improve the biology. So the take home message for today is that we need absolutely to improve our investigation in these patients in terms of anamnesis, since we need to understand the lifestyle in these patients. We need to reduce stressors. We need to help through the psychologist and nutritionist the ability to recover a more stable way of living and on one side to get food. Integrative approach, absolutely important, if possible, having a normal feeding, which is the really first important intervention. And we might act combining integrative approach through carnitines and other substances, as well as combining them probably with very low levels of estradiol or very low levels of estriol, such as I have demonstrated you. But importantly, we need to think that at the moment that we have to recover the estrogenization in these patients, since the biology is not starting to produce estradiol from the ovary, we probably do not have to act using ethinyl estradiol plus progestins, but probably using oral contraceptive with the bioidentical estradiol, with estradiol inside, since such kind of estradiol is able to induce a specific biological effects all over the biology, inside the brain, on the muscles, on the connective tissues, and mainly on the bone. Thank you very much, and excuse me for being so long in this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Alessandro. I would like now to call also Biagio, and then we have a huge series of questions. I want to focus the importance that we have two masters on the area covered by the topic on functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. And today we started with Biagio and Alessandro speaking about the development of the syndrome, the important hypothalamic modification, and how hypothalamus is sensitive not only to the hormone, but also to the food and quality, and how the metabolic factors are also important. But I am sure that, and we had a beautiful number of public rising, nearly 250 persons together, and I'm sure that we can have also another one, a webinar on the other part of the life, what is reproduction in women who had functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, and also what it will be the menopause in women with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. But moving now to the question, we have a first question for Biagio, for you. How can we summarize the fundamental role of kisspeptin in female reproduction? No, open the microphone. Yes.
Yeah, can you hear me? Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Thank you for good question. I think to be short that there are a few aspects, but first aspect is that kisspeptin is the direct regulator of GnRH. It means it's positive regulator. Another point is that it reaches the different signal. Like Professor Alessandro told, signal from instance from leptin, from insulin, and from the stress, in other words, from CRH, and is the mediator of this stimuli, direct mediator to the GnRH regulation. This is the aspect, let's say, for the adult patients in the reproductive age. But also probably it has very important impact on the puberty onset. We still don't know exactly, but it's the kind of the strongest candidate to trigger the GnRH and LH pulsatility through the interaction between, let's say, leptin influence on the NPY on the kisspeptin, and kisspeptin can trigger the GnRH LH pulsatility.
Thank you very much, Blase. And now a question from Vilma Kovac, Alessandro. It's very interesting because it's such an important clinical point. Her question is, why weight gain in some women with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea doesn't restore menstrual cycle?
This is a very interesting question, but I have a very simple answer for you. Let's think that you have the wallet in your pocket and you have a very good friend close to you. Then you go back home and you have no more the wallet. And you find that the wallet is now in the pocket of your friend. So he has just stolen the wallet to you. So the day after, when you go out, do you believe that it's safe to have your friend close to your pocket with the new wallet in your pocket? I don't think so. So whenever the biology lose weight, suffer for the stress, or have not a good nutrition, it creates a sort of situation and conditions that determines a reaction, which is negative for reproduction, but create a sort of alert inside the biology. So inside your biology, someone on the black book writes the names of the situations that you had. Once you recover the weight, or you try to have solved at least the nutrition aspects, well, the biology is still not convinced that this is not enough and does not trust so much the fact that the body is the only real solution to again have the restoration of the menstruations. So we have found, which is not a scientific, obviously, rule, but we have understood that you need to maintain a perfect control of the feeding at least for 4 months in a row in patients that need to start the recovery of the hypothalamus pituitary functions. And the data that we have, which are not absolutely indicative for all women, but clearly demonstrate us that the first changes in the LH plasma levels start to appear when considering the integration or the treatment with low estrogens is able to be effective together with nutrition, which is stable and more rich in nutrients adapted for such kind of recovery for at least 4 months. So the combination of body weight recovery needs to be together with something improving the ability of the endogenous system to reactivate, trusting you, the reproductive axis. So you can gain weight eating cakes, pizza, pasta, but you need food, the exact good food for getting reproduction and your health to be restored, which is meat, vegetables, and also obviously pizza, bread, and pasta, but in the right amounts, not just one, but you need all three aspects of nutrition.
Thank you, Alessandro. But you see, these patients who take weight but don't start again, they still remain a question in many clinical centers. And then I have a question from Susanna Nizanska. An interesting observation, Blase, for you. Thank you for excellent lecture. Question: did you look also to prolactin levels in connection to the stress mechanism in amenorrheic patients? I do not mean high prolactin levels causing amenorrhea for differential diagnosis. I mean, if you met low prolactin levels, and she mentioned that they had a small group of patients in which chronic stress, exhausting, and even a kind of depression was connected with low prolactin.
Yes. Thank you for the question. Interesting observation. In my experience, I rather found to also our study with Alessandro that when we measure the mean serum levels of the prolactin from, let's say, group of the patient, rather prolactin was in the higher normal range than low prolactin. It means that our observation is rather more high prolactin levels. No, we didn't find the real low, very low serum prolactin levels in this group of the patients.
Thank you. No, you know, I think
I can add something.
Yes,
please.
It's just an observation, but this is a data that we made a few months ago, just checking a relatively large group of patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, that the level of prolactin are related positively with the level of LH. So whenever we have a sort of chronic condition of stress that is getting LH very low or very reduced toward the zero, maybe LH of 0.2, 0.3, quite frequently we have low levels of prolactin, which are around 4, about 5 nanograms per milliliter. So we found, and these are data that you can check in the literature, as an indirect demonstration of a sort of exhaustion of the function of the pituitary to produce proteic hormones. So for us, at least, low levels of prolactin within the normal range in patients who are very stressed, we know, with a high level of cortisol, but normal or very low level of prolactin and LH, is an indication of the lack of proteins. And we got a simple observation of the recovery of prolactin, just changing the way of having food in this patient.
Thank you. Very interesting.
Thank observation. You. Thank you.
And then now, Alessandro, we have, I will put together three questions. One is from Marianna Minetti. She asked, concerning the patient that you are giving a small dose estradiol, if this patient, do you suggest to use estradiol every day or just for 21, 25 days per month? And what about progesterone? And at the same time, I would like to put you the question from Maria Eugenia Escobar, and she asked, at which point would you induce menstruation with progesterone in the recovery process? And also, Susanna Santagni, that we know well, how long is recommended to use low estrogen in the treatment of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea?
Okay, it's a complex reply, my one, but it's very easy. The incipit, the beginning of the story is to treat constantly these patients with very low levels of estrogen. So you have to reinduce the expression of the ability of the Kisspeptin neurons to work on one side. And as we have demonstrated in a group of patients with the Kallmann syndrome, we were able to demonstrate that the low level of estrogens were able to reinduce the expression of GnRH receptors inside the pituitary cells. So the idea is to start with very low level of estrogens, and the target is to have 3 months, 4 months, 5 months of very low levels of treatment in these patients, and checking LH. As soon as we have the recovery of the levels of LH, which are not able probably to reinduce the starting of the ovarian function, you might start adding small amount of progesterone. Natural progesterone is the best one, just trying to restart somehow the menstruations. On my side, I have to say that we avoid to use the addition of progesterone or progestin, since we want to have the ability to get the biology to improve by herself the amount of LH in response to the treatment. In the case we are able to get somehow normal level of LH, then we reduce the treatment using the calendar days of the month. You have estrogens only from the first day of the month up to the 20th. Just then you stop and let's see what's going on. And if the levels of LH are quite high or relatively high in between 7 and 10, well, you might have the restoration of some production of estradiol from the ovaries. And this is important since the low level of estradiol that we are using or estriol that we are using is not able, we demonstrated this, to change the estradiolemia, the level of estradiol in the blood, in the circulating blood. So if you find that estradiol is said in these patients is going from 10, 15 to 30, 45, 70, well, this is the signal that the ovarian function is restarting. Consider that it's a classic. Professor Bruni, she is the magister of such kind of teaching, She is always saying that functional hypothalamic amenorrhea is the going back in the time of these ladies up to the prepubertal period. So think a little bit to the prepubertal period. You have a very low levels of LH, then you have the rising of LH, you start to have a little bit increasing of level of estradiol, and then after some months, 6 or 8 months from the going up of LH and estradiol, you have the very first menstruations and menarche occurs. So we have to think a little bit on such kind of very physiological event, and we need to restore and restart such kind of event in these patients.
Thank you. And then now a question for Blase. You were speaking about the use of kisspeptin. And the question is, can you describe side effects related to kisspeptin administration?
Okay, thank you for the question. So far in the literature, we can find maybe several publications. Some of them I maybe cited 70% of the publication. And as I know, there are no important side effects, only small IV side effects were observed during this administration, like headaches, like dizziness, diarrhea, and sweating. It means that it was not something important in the sense of the side effects, and the patient were in the good condition during the study.
Thank you. And then Alessandro, a question from Su Ling Yu. What is the cause of hypogonadism due to taking oral contraceptive?
Well, the problem of the reduction of the level of LH in patients taking contraceptives is the effects, the combined effects of ethinyl estradiol plus progestins. Progestins are very tight and effective substances reducing the release of GnRH and of the gonadotropins from the pituitary. And this is the key element, just to better understand the fact that we need, in these patients, the use of estrogens which are bioidentical, because in these patients, as in all women, ethinyl estradiol has no degradation in other compounds useful for the biology. So estradiol in the bioequivalent functions is able to be transformed in estriol and estrone. And this creates conditions that improves the efficacy of estrogens in this kind of contraception to manipulate and positively affect elements that are, affected by the functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, the bone, the brain, the preservation of the elastic fibers inside the connective, inside the biology, and also in the ability of the muscles to have an optimal functioning.
Thank you. And then now another for Blase. What is the main mechanism related to kisspeptin role in pathophysiology of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea?
Thank you. There are a lot of elements, but I think that main elements of kisspeptin action is the action of the influence of different stressors, like typical stress and the mediation of increase of the CRH and the inhibition of the kisspeptin. And in turn, kisspeptin will not stimulate the GnRH secretion. This is, in my opinion, the critical point from the typical stress-related amenorrhea. And another point, when the background of the hypofunctional hypothalamic amenorrhea will be related to the metabolic state. If it's, for instance, undernutrition, will be the pathway of leptin, smaller secretion of the leptin, and also influence on the kisspeptin. And kisspeptin will not give the positive signal to stimulate GnRH secretion. In this situation, we will have the disarrangement of the GnRH pulsatility, and the final result will be hypogonadotropic hypoestrogenism.
Thank you. And then one for Alessandro. We put together two questions from an anonymous, two anonymous. Eh? One is that are very interesting, but they are the similar. My question is, if hypothalamic amenorrhea can occur also in perimenopausal women that experience high intensity physical exercise and weight loss? And the other question is, until which age we can expect hypothalamic amenorrhea?
So let's start from the second one. Yes. We can expect hypothalamic amenorrhea all along the fertile life in women. So we have no limits in between the area close to the menarche up to the, let's say, 40s. So whenever a woman is undergoing to physical stressors, undernutrition, psychological stress, well, all this is able to affect the reproductive ability. It has to be said that the biology in women is more sensitive during menarche or immediately after the beginning of the first menstruation, because in that period of life, women are changing, growing, are building the body mass in terms of muscles, organs, bones. So the biology is really working hard to maintain and create the final physical shape of that woman. So there is a lot of energy to be used to maintain the evolution of that body. And so in that moment, probably there is a higher vulnerability. The fact that perimenopausal period might be a moment in which hypothalamic amenorrhea might occur, yes, this is truth. We have absolutely seen a lot of patients of this kind. Let me joke on this. The so-called, I see these women with a little bit of smiling, they are the so-called evergreen women, those that are keeping everything under control. I need to be on diet. I need to go to the gym. I have to perform perfectly. Well, the fact is that stress is always acting heavily in these patients as in the younger ladies. But during this moment of life, there is a changes in the ability of the hypothalamic functioning and the pituitary functioning producing gonadotropins. So perimenopausal period is characterized by the slow rising of FSH and LH towards menopause, while ovary is reducing the ovarian functions because it's exhausting the presence of follicles. So the presence of stress depresses and decreases the level of gonadotropins, creating a reduction of the stimulation of the ovarian function. So these women reduce the amount of follicles maturing and reaching ovulation, maintain very low level of estradiol produced, do not have obviously hot flashes and symptoms, but LH and FSH are relatively decreased in the levels, which are almost close to the normality, but a little bit lower than those expected for the women of that age. So in perimenopause 48, 47, you might have FSH 15, 17 at the third day of the follicular phase. Well, these patients have a 10 or maybe a 9 with a very low level of estradiol, no symptoms, but no occurrence of menstruations because the FSH is relatively low to stimulate the ovarian recruitment of follicles.
Thank
so you,
you
can expect the occurrence of menopause 3-4 years after, when the ovary has completely exhausted all the follicles available.
Thank you, Alessandro. And then now, okay, we are approaching to the end. A question from Maria Eugenia Escobar. For Blase, for you, in the case of a need for contraception, which method would you choose in adolescent amenorrheic patient with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea?
Generally, as I observe, we don't need the contraception in such patient because it's kind of the endogenous contraception and is very low serum levels of estradiol. But if the patient will be very, encouraged by herself to have the contraception, Probably we can consider the contraception based on the natural estrogen. Will be the in my opinion the best choice. Not we should avoid like Alexandro told, we should not prescribe this group of the patient a contraception with ethinyl estradiol.
Thank you. And then now, Alessandro, a question from Tatiana Tulchenko. What about the possibility of functional hypothalamic amenorrhea in lean polycystic ovary girls?
This is a very good point. The starting is the understanding of PCOS in these patients. We have to remember that the ultrasound shape that we might see with such kind of diagnosis gives us the idea of an ovarian blockade, because the classic ultrasound with a PCO is typical when you do not have a good ovarian stimulation through the levels of gonadotropins. So functional hypothalamic amenorrhea is almost rare in patients who are hyperandrogenic due to specific conditions of androgen production, which is from the ovary, because those who have such kind of hyperproduction of androgens have a very high or elevated levels of LH and FSH, and quite often, not always, high level of insulin. So when you have a classic morphology of PCO in the ultrasound and you have a very low levels of LH, and you have a relatively high level of androgens, probably these are not coming from the ovary, but these are coming from a higher stimulation of the adrenal gland. So you have to check, together with the low levels of LH and the morphology of PCO, you have to check the dehydroepiandrosterone, 17-hydroxyprogesterone, and maybe cortisol, because if you have the elevation of these, well, the aspect that you have at ultrasound is a fake image for the real PCOS, but is an index of a sort of a negative effect in the control of the ovary. And on one side, it should suggest somehow that the adrenal gland is hyperactivated. And this is typical. This is typical.
Thank you. Okay, now we are at the end. And I would like that to finish, as always, with general consideration from each one of you related to the importance of the area that you were evaluating. Then, first of all, Blase, then I would like your final comment about the importance and how to assess and to study the role of kisspeptin in this so complicated functional regulation of the hypothalamus, who is also facing different moments during the human life, different condition, and different risk for the proper hypothalamic function.
Yes, it is very good field to study, generally functional hypothalamic amenorrhea. But now when we have this new element, which is kisspeptin, is even more interesting, because previously, before the area of the kisspeptin, epoch of kisspeptin, we study only GnRH or LH. I think that will be nice to study the kisspeptin in the bigger group of the patient than so far, or also maybe improve the quantity of the group to administer the kisspeptin in the patient with hypothalamic amenorrhea, and maybe the another way of administration will be better, because as I presented, subcutaneous administration or intravenous, but maybe the use of the pump, like for instance GnRH is used in the pump, the using the kisspeptin, use of kisspeptin based on the pump, like insulin is used, maybe will be kind of the new innovation.
Thank you very much. And then Alessandro, you are speaking about the role of nutrients in general and the possible integrative use of substances, as you mentioned, as acetyl-carnitine, N-levocysteine, and carnitine, and also the addition of other substances able to interfere in the mechanism of oxidation. Can you give us a final comment about that one?
Well, the comment is that whenever we have patients with functional hypothalamic amenorrhea, the suggestion that I give is, please act as doctors. You need to investigate the patient, try to understand the patient, then think and act as gynecologists. So the very first step is to try to focus on the way of living of these patients, hoping to improve the ability to cope with the conditions, environmental factors that are triggering the stressors. The second action is to understand at what level we have the stressors and what kind of modulation, negative modulation we have on hormones. So check LH, FT3, insulin, amylase, just to understand at what level the metabolism is affected together with the reproduction. The third one, try to focus on the solution. So feeding, better control of nutrients, reduce physical activity, and third and fourth important point, introduce integrations in these patients, acting on the higher amount possible points. So perfect carnitines, N-acetylcysteine, arginine, low level of estradiol or low level of estriol, since everything is important and relevant to try to move the machine towards a reactivation of the system. But remember, metabolism is the key factor of reproduction and a main conductor of every one of us to good health.
Thank you very much, dear friends. It was a fantastic webinar. We had a lot of success, and I would like now to thank you and to invite everybody to our next webinar. Our next webinar will be the 6th of June, and it will be on a totally different topics. And we will have two fantastic gentlemen present with us, Yves Wiel from Paris and Gerard Visser from Holland. They will speak about, should all pregnancies be induced at 39 weeks? This is the question, we will be the answer. I thank all of you for being with us. And I would like also to remind you that our next Congress, the 15th Congress of the European Society of Gynecology, will be in Amsterdam. It will be from 29th of November to the 2nd of December. Please come with us, register to the conference, send your abstract for oral presentation or poster. We will have a fantastic event in the beautiful Dutch city that is Amsterdam. Then thank you for being with us. Thank you, Blase. Thank you, Alessandro.
Thank you.
We will
see
each other soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you.